Good evening and welcome to the Planning Committee. My name is Councillor Anita Leach and I'm Chair of the Planning Committee. We have just started a webcasting, so I need to read out some information regarding that webcasting. I'm sure you've seen the orange signs that you're going to say that we are webcasting and it will be given up to the council website, but let me read you this. Our meeting this evening will be webcast. You may have seen the notices on your agenda papers and signage on the doors as you entered. In addition to this, the live transmission, a recording of this meeting will also be placed on the council's website to allow members of the public and other interested parties to view our proceedings and decisions. To members of the public, our cameras have been set to view the proceedings of our debate, and anyone sitting in the public gallery should not appear on camera. What actually happens is, as the microphone is on, the camera tracks to that microphone. I should point out that if any applicants, lead petitioners or agents do not wish to appear on camera, please make this known to me before you take your seat at the table. Members, please ensure that you activate your microphone before speaking in view of the fact that it's tracked to the camera is tracked to your microphone. And as you finish speaking, if you can turn it off as well, please. It also allows for members of the public that are sitting near the back to be able to hear you if you use your microphone. Okay, I assume there's no questions about that one. Okay. My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. Can I please ask if anyone present can turn off their mobile phones or put them to silent? To explain who the rest of the people on the tables here tonight are, to my immediate left is the council's solicitor, who will advise the committee on any procedural or legal matters. We also have the highway officer and the environmental officer to my left. To my right are the council officers who will be doing the presentations this evening and will be given any technical advice that the committee might seek to have answered. The rest of the people you see down both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualifying petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition, if there are two, then both of the representatives of those petitions can come forward for a maximum of 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or the agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the residents. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public area, they may not return to take part in any debate that may be followed by the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. The order of tonight's agenda may vary, subject to the numbers of people who are here in relation to a specific agenda item, and subject to the committee agreeing to the order being varied. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee, this matter will not be discussed any further this evening and will be on a subsequent date. Members, on pages 1 to 12 of your papers, you have the minutes. Can I have approval of those minutes, please? Yeah. Okay. Kathy?
Yes, during the judicial review update, David Elton, Councillor Elton mentioned the debate on Hill Park and not allow David to reply, saying it was an application that was invalid. And David asked about enforcement, and Matthew said they wanted to enforce after the planning application submitted. That's not mentioned in the minutes under the judicial review.
I think in relation to that issue, the discussions that were entered into between myself and the three, and as that was an issue which was specific to forms of four, points of matter, then any reference to another hotel or body that was not appropriate to be referred to within that particular minute.
The report didn't relate to that particular venue.
Okay, so are we happy for me to sign the minutes? Thank you. Moving to agenda item two, are there any declarations of interest? Steve?
Chair, due to my position as a board director at Magenta Living, I shall declare prejudicial interest on item four, and I shall leave the room and take no part in any debate.
Thank you, Steve. Are there any requests for site visits? No. Okay, thank you. Can I suggest to members that the Acre Lane application is deferred this evening? In light of the substantive additional information sent to members and officers this week, officers would like to defer the planning application to the 19th of July planning committee in order that this very detailed document from the objectives can be fully considered. This will ensure the final recommendation and decision is robust and has taken account of all the relevant issues. Can I have your approval for that, please?
Yes, Chair, that's fine, thank you.
Okay, I appreciate that we've deferred once for members of the public in terms of having a site visit at Acre Lane, but I do think it's important that we have absolutely correct information in terms of the report that comes to this committee, and I would just ask you to be patient with us in terms of that. Okay, thank you. If you would like to leave now, you'd be more than welcome to do so.
Celia.
If people towards the back of the hall would like to move forward, then please feel free to do so.
Hey, Chris.
Members, we have people here for agenda items 4, 7 and the people for 8 have obviously just left. Can I suggest that we alter the agenda so that we cover item 7 before items 5 and 6? Can I have your approval for that? Okay, so if we move to agenda item 4, first of all, that is pages 13 to 16 in your packs, and see if you're going to leave with that. Okay. Can we have a presentation when you're ready, please?
Thank you, Chair. This application is for the erection of 6 houses and 1 bungalow at the site of garages on the corner of Marbledale Close and Darlingdale Drive. The site is considered to constitute brownfield land within the primary and residential area, and the principle of development site is therefore acceptable. The 6 two-storey houses are front onto Marbledale Close. The houses have been sited so that separating distances of 14 metres and 21 metres are met with the existing properties to the front, rear and side of the site. The proposed bungalow will be located on an existing grass area on the southern part of the site. The bungalow will form the established building line of Darlingdale Drive, and given that it's located on the corner, will address both Marbledale Close and Darlingdale Drive to ensure that it contributes regionally to the character of the area. The proposed dwelling is considered to be suitable for this area, for the mix of brickwork, front canopy and window details are of sufficient interest. In general, the proposed dwelling is considered to enhance the appearance of the site. The proposal will result in the loss of about 45 garages, and a number of objections have been received on these grounds. However, the site is private land, and these garages could be removed from use without planning permission being required. Each of the new dwellings has one off-street parking space, whilst an additional area of 7 parking spaces is to be created within the site adjacent to an existing electricity pylon. Each dwelling has a good sized rear garden, and the amount of development is therefore considered to be suitable for this site, but pot size is consistent with the surrounding area. With regards to concerns of the emergency vehicles accessing the site, the carriageway is a sufficient width for emergency and refuge vehicles, and access arrangements to the property to the rear, 2 to 20 mile depth pumps, is not being altered. In conclusion, the proposed development will make a good use of the existing brownfield site and will not have an adverse impact on the immediate neighbouring properties or the character and appearance of the street scene. The proposal is therefore recommended for approval, subject to the attached conditions. Thank you.
Thank you. We do have a petition on this particular application. Is the petitioner here to speak on this? No? Okay. Do we have a board councillor to speak on this? No? Then I'll open this up to committee, please. Dave?
Yes, thank you, Chair. Looking at the detail of this, I believe that it's a good use for a brownfield site, and I think we should be encouraging approval of these types of developments. So it's got my support, Chair.
Are you moving
approval?
Thank you.
Can I have a second, Chair?
Thank you. Ron. All those in favour of approval, subject to the conditions listed? That's unanimous. Can somebody get a seat back, thank you. If you want to get ready, we're going to move to agenda item 7 now, which is pages 29 to 36 of your maps. We're just moving to agenda item 7. 29. When you're ready, can we have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair. This application is for a two-storey south extension to provide two additional apartments to an existing building which contains three apartments. The application was deferred from planning permission on the 31st of March to allow members to visit the site. If the application site contains a large 70-thatched Victorian property fronting off the Snighty Road at its junction with Grafton Street, the building has substantial character but is neither listed nor in a conservation area. The application property is one of a pair of 70-thatched properties located between Grafton Street and Greenville. The width of each of these pots is between 22 to 24 metres, which is considerably larger than most of the other pots in the immediate area. For comparison, properties on Grafton Street are approximately 7 metres in width, and those on Reedville are approximately 12 metres in width. The area to the south of 25 Snighty Road is approximately 13 metres, and is therefore considered that some form of development to the side is acceptable in principle. The design of the proposed extension has been amended from the original submission. The amended design now reflects the design of the original property with a stone window detailing, bay feature and pitched roof. Overall, the extension will appear as a small and subordinate version of the original building. The front of the extension will be in line with the main front elevation of the existing property, although to the side it will project closer to Grafton Street than the original building. Most of the properties on this side of Grafton Street are set back from the pavement by around 3 metres, but the coach house to the rear site actually adjoining the back of the pavement. The proposed extension is set back 5 metres and will therefore ensure that it does not appear unduly prominent or intrusive on the street scene of Grafton Street. The proposed extension also addresses Grafton Street with this side elevation containing similar details as the main front elevation. This will result in a contributing positive wind to the street scene of Grafton Street. The proposal will also include a new car park at the front of the site together with amended access onto Snighty Road. This will require the removal of an lime tree, which is now covered by a tree preservation order. The applicant has provided evidence to show that this lime tree is causing structural damage to the boundary wall and has to be removed. The site will retain good tree cover, but the condition also being attached for a landscaping scheme to be submitted. proposed extension has been cited, so it's one rear elevation, approximately 13.4 metres from the main elevation of the property to the rear, and there's one Grafton Street. This is just below the garden line distance of 14 metres. However, the pattern of development in this area is such that it's considered to be acceptable. For reference, there are habitable windows on property on Reading and Grafton Street, which face each other at a similar distance of about 13 metres, which is a significant shortfall from the normal requirements of 24 metres. Therefore, in this instance, the minor shortfall of 0.6 metres is considered to be acceptable. In conclusion, the proposed development is considered to make best use of this site and will not have an unacceptable adverse impact on the appearance and setting of the original building, the character of the street scene, for the amenities and neighbouring properties. The proposal therefore recommends approval, subject to the attached conditions. Thank you.
Thank you. We do have a qualifying petition for this. Is there any petition here to speak? Would you like to come forward, sir?
Yes.
Are you happy to come forward?
Yes.
You'll see that it should be a button in the middle for you to press. Would you mind stating your... Would you mind stating... Is that on? Yeah. Would you mind stating your name and address for the records?
My name is Mark Evans from the Coach House, 31 Grafton Street, CH434UJ.
Thank you. You have 5 minutes.
As I said, my name is Mark Evans. My wife and two small children live at the Coach House, which backs onto the proposed site of the planning application. You also, most of you came round to do the actual site visit itself. I know that the planning officer's recommendations carry a lot of weight when deciding these matters, but I'm also aware that your duties go beyond that. I'm not here just to say not in my backyard, the NIMBY side of things. I'm here to represent my family, and also the 23 other people who thought it important to propose to put their registered objections to the proposed extension. These people did not say NIMBY either. They genuinely believe that the area of the proposed extension needs protecting and that it will have an adverse effect on the street scene and the amenities of the neighbouring area. On the planning officer's report, most of the objections were addressed. However, the issue of loss of light does not seem to be a factor in that. During your site visit, I was very keen for you to come into the garden and to come into my house to see what impact the proposed building would have and the effect that it would have on our quality of life living there. I know a few of you went up the fire escape and had a look down. I went up the fire escape after you'd been up there and looked down, and I couldn't see a thing because of the tree coverage that there. So I don't think you've actually got a good view of what you could or what you would expect to see. I know the legal system recognises the value of natural light inside residential buildings and the need for local planning authorities to protect its residents, and also to see what effect the new build will have upon the existing residential property. Now, as you've already seen on your site visit, we have houses all the way around our property. Some houses are three stories, so they're quite high. These buildings block a lot of light, especially in the winter and autumn months, because where the light comes up from the east and swings around and drops down to the west on a southerly approach, all those houses are on that path of the sun, okay? So that sort of blocks most of our lights during the autumn, winter, and some of the spring months as well. Where the winter, where it comes down into the, and looks where the proposed site is going to be, that is our main living area, that's our main window that looks out onto to that area there. We do have two small windows in that lounge, however, those windows are approximately 30 centimetres high, and they look out onto the neighbouring building, which is approximately 8 metres away. I've not seen a site layout plan for daylight or sunlight for this development. But using the thumb, rule of thumb for the development, directly affecting the window, it should be 25 degrees vertical angle from the centre of that window. I can tell you now it's definitely not 25 degrees, it's a lot higher. And as I said, that is the main window which emit lights to our lounge, which is our main living area. Also, to use the separation of the houses between Grafton Street and Reedville, I think it's quite unjust. The coach house was only made into a residential dwelling in 1967, so everything that was built on there sort of predates all that. So that, I should say that, you know, everything's, it was like that. It's set a precedence, I don't think it does. So I think that's something you could consider. And in all belief, I honestly believe that if this extension were to go ahead, that it would have a huge and adverse effect on my family's quality of life. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mr. Evans, and thank you for giving me the time. I think you would like to return to it. Is the applicant here to speak with us?
Yes.
Would you come forward, sir? Again, if I can ask you to state your name and address, we are happy to do so. And also, if you turn on the microphone, you'll have 5 minutes. It should be on the face behind it. Okay, thank you. Are you ready, sir?
Thank you. Chair, members of the committee, good evening. I'm Edward Landor of Landor Planning Consultants Limited. I speak on behalf of the agent, the Bunting Partnership, who regrettably could not attend due to a family bereavement. Number 25 Slater Road is a large semi-detached Victorian property comprising three number apartments. The application is to add a two-storey side extension accommodating two one-bedroom apartments with a new lobby entrance, providing access to all five apartments and a car park with 8 car spaces. Number 25 is one of a pair of semi-detached properties which, whilst not symmetrical, nevertheless make a positive contribution to the street scene. The properties are located in a primarily residential area in accordance with the adopted development plan and are not listed or in a conservation area. The principle of residential development is therefore acceptable. Your planning officers have prepared a comprehensive report which includes very detailed information with regard to the dimension of the plot and separation distance from adjacent dwellings. The conclusion of that assessment is the extension of number 21 is an appropriate design solution which makes efficient use of a substantial plot and satisfies the council standards regarding minimum interface distances. Ensuring that a scheme satisfies planning standards and can be accommodated in site planning terms is essential. As the planning officer's report confirms, the rear elevation of the extension is 40 metres from the coach house and 30 metres to the nearest dwelling to the front and side of the property. In addition, the outlook from the coach house will be much enhanced by the removal of an unsightly fire escape staircase. Just one other point to make about sunlight. The coach house is orientated on a north-south access, and of course, it's only in the evening that there will be any lot of light. However, the point which I particularly wish to emphasise is that the scheme was originally submitted as a flat roof contemporary style addition. It has evolved in the course of the determination of this application, in my view, into a sympathetic, subservient extension, which will sit very comfortably adjacent to the host property. It incorporates many features which take reference from the original building. These include a shallow pitched roof to match the pediment feature of the original building, matching terracotta brick elevations, buff coloured reconstituted stone plinth and bancourse, and sandstone heads and sills wall window openings. The extension is set in line with the main elevation of the existing building and behind the main bay, which projects further forward. In terms of siting, scale, mass, and detailed design, the proposed extension represents good architectural manners, and I have no doubt that it will make a positive and handsome contribution to the character of the street scene. The proposal also includes a new car park with 8 car spaces for 5 apartments. The access to the car park is to be repositioned and widened, which provides a highway safety benefit. This will require the removal of a lime tree which your planning officer report advises has been covered by a precautionary TPO. However, irrespective of your decision tonight, the tree will be removed for arboricultural reasons as it's causing structural damage to the boundary wall. Notwithstanding its removal, the front of the site retains good tree cover, and if approved, your officers recommend that a landscape scheme is submitted as a condition of approval. Your planning officers have prepared a comprehensive and robust assessment of the application, concluding that the proposed extension will not have an adverse impact upon the appearance and setting of the original building, the character of the street scene and the amenities of neighbouring properties. Indeed, we say it will make a positive contribution, having regard to all aspects, social, economic and environmental. A broader reason stating that we would invite you to support your officer's recommendation for our application. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and thank you for staying a long time. Could I just like you to turn your back to the phone, please?
Of course.
Thank you. Okay, is there a board councillor to speak on this? Okay, can I open it up to committee? Ian?
Procedural matter first, Chairman, member of the legal advisor being my assistants. I understood that, and no disrespect to Mr. Landor, who's spoken to us, but I understood it is the applicant or their agent who has the right to address the committee on behalf of the application. Mr. Landor is neither.
Chair and colleagues, we've had some discussion about the angles and all the rest of it, but it seems to me that a visual viewing it was quite sufficient to certainly demonstrate to me that there will be, I think, a profound loss of amenity and light for the neighbours who would be half overlooked. I can certainly see that it would be commercially advantageous to the developer, and I can't blame the developer for thinking that way, but I also think that it's reasonable that we should have regard to the expectations of existing residents and homeowners. After all, they made their investments in the first place in the reasonable expectation that new buildings of this sort would be most likely to occur in that particular locality in the village, so many houses are already there, which to my way of thinking is quite, would be thought to be completely improbable at the time when they made their investment. So I don't think they should be allowed.
Thank you, Adrian Stewart.
Thanks, Chair. Can I thank the committee for agreeing to site visits at the last reason and for what's been said, clearly it was a useful site visit so that members could see the relationship of the new extension to the coach house at number 31. May I just agree with the agent or otherwise of the applicant when he says that it's essential that planning guidelines are met when we're looking at application. I agree entirely. The problem is, of course, that planning guidelines are not met with regard to this application. SPD 2 specifically says that our guidelines for separation distance between habitable rooms and blank walls is 14 metres. The report says nearly 14 metres. It's actually closer to 13 metres. Now, you know, we can dance on the head of a pair of guests on a metre here or a metre there, but if we're setting the bar at a certain height, and if the applicant suggests that we should follow our own guidelines, then I would suggest that we ought to follow our own guidelines. And even more so in this instance, as you will have seen on site, the view and the outlook from the house will move from 31, and as Adrian has pointed out, it's just unacceptable for the amenity of that household. And I don't think the comparison between Gafford and Meadville stands for scrutiny. Chair, I do have potential reasons for refusal, which I would like to put to the committee once the members have made their views on.
Thank you, Stuart. Steve?
Yeah, thanks, Chair. It was an interesting site visit, and they are quite magnificent buildings, the two semis that are together, and that's what makes part of Swainsborough attractive. I am torn between the benefits to the frontage onto 25, from 25 onto Swainsborough Road, given that clearly when the new extension goes up, I would hope we would have a condition that the other part of the Victorian property is sort of upgraded in line, so the new bit doesn't look new and the old bit just looks as it is now. So I'm hoping there will be some matching of those two frontages when it's developed. And I actually think the removal of some of the trees at the front then would open that up to the street scene, and the car parking issue is clearly something that is of beneficial nature, I think, to the road safety issues that as mentioned. You then have to balance that up about what the people on Swainsborough Road don't see and the people living at the back see. If we'd have put windows in the back to break up the fascia of that building, it would have been classed as overlooking. And now it's sort of just going to war, it has that effect of overbearing. So it is a real difficult decision to make, in my mind, of whether the advantages to the frontage and more properties being built in an area where people want to live, and upgrading what is a fairly dilapidated building against the effect on the people who live in the coach house, which is a strangely orientated build, position of the building. It's an infill site, I think, going back to 1967, if you would call that, to the street scene within Grafton Street itself. Having represented this, used to be our ward many few years back. So I am familiar with the area. So it really is a balanced decision of what the major advantages are against that the overbearing effect on the property area. So we remain open minds and possibly would be interested in listening to what the reasons for refusing might.
Thank you,
Steve.
Cathy?
Thank you,
Chair. I'm on the site visit. One of the things that I find concerning that Stuart has already alluded to is the fact it is slightly less than our guidelines. It's 13 metres or just under 14. It's still under 14. But the real issue for me is the fact, and I have used the phrase before in this meeting about the further wall type effect. And the rear of the proposed extension will be approximately a metre from what appears to be the garden area of the coach house. And I would tend to veer towards Stuart's prognosis here, that this really is rather overbearing. I would not like to have a property in front of me that is only a metre from our house. Thank you, Cathy. Ian?
Thanks, I think, having heard from Stuart and from the residents, from the lead petitioner, and the site visits, I think, as Councillor Farks said, is very useful in the sense that from the front, it looks like quite an impressive development. When the street scene is opened up, because the lime tree has to be removed anyway, it's going to be removed. So that from the front, if you pass in, it will look more pleasant and more acceptable. But that's if you pass in. If you're a pedestrian or a driver, great, it looks nice, but for somebody who lives 24 hours, 7 days a week from the back, it's not an improvement to the street scene. My concern would be that the separation distances mentioned by the planning officer in his presentation, quoting the difference between the properties in Grafton Street and Reedville, well, of course, that's the rear of the properties. The property, the coach house, the front of the coach house will overlook this development. So the distance applies even more in this case than it does to Reedville and Grafton Street, because they're the back of the properties. If you live in the front of the property in the coach house, as the petitioner does, they can be facing this the back of this property forevermore. So I don't think that is an improvement to their street scene. That's the reasons that I've heard from Councillor Kelly and Councillor Hudson, I would be minded to move the refusal.
Thank you, Ian.
Yeah, just a very brief comment, Chair, actually. As one who went on the site visit, I thought it was, as usual, a very beneficial opportunity to see what was going on there. If I was to allude to the Man on the Oxford Omnibus, I think one would suggest that the existing building is already very dominant and in fact takes the light from the coach house at the time of day when one would expect it to be clear if you live in a normal open environment. So one could say, well, they've had to put up with that because that the original building was there a lot longer than the coach house was and they decided to move there. But having said that, looking at what is shown on the screen here and looking at the rear elevation and realising what is going on with this, I believe the extension is a bridge too far. It is taking far too much of the amenity value of the neighbour at the coach house away, and it's making what is already a problematical situation with regard to light even worse. So, as the others have said, I would be inclined to support the a refusal subject to what Seward has to actually say. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, do you have anybody else wants to make any comments? Can we move to the refusal, please, Stuart?
Thanks, Chair. Members have mentioned overbearing, neighbourliness and amenity, so don't be too surprised if those words appear in my resolution here. The application being refused for the following reason. The proposal would result in a development which would, due to its scale and sighting, have an overbearing and neighbourly impact upon the amenities of the neighbouring property, which is contrary to supplementary planning document 2 and the National Planning Policy Framework.
Okay, thank you, Stuart. Do
we
have a second,
please?
I'd be happy to second that.
Okay, thank you. All those in favour of refusal? Okay, that's unanimous, that's carried, so this application will not go forward. Okay, so this has been moved as a substantial motion.
We need to move it as a substantive motion now because the
Don't
think
that's okay.
Sorry. As it's been a vote to refuse this, and the obviously the recommendation is approval, we need to vote to substantiate that motion.
So, if we need to move it as a substantive
motion. Chair, I mean, we haven't had to increase, but I've no issue in approving moving a substantive motion on the lines that I've already.
Do we have a second for that, David? You're going to second that again? Thank you. All those in favour of the substantive motion?
Than and the purpose of including that in the existing development.
The existing building is not listed or of any architectural merit and is considered to fall within the definition of previously developed land. The replacement building has a smaller footprint and slightly lower eaves height than the existing building, but the height of the ridge will be 1.3 metres higher than the original building. Two proposed dormers will have add some bulk to roof space, but in general terms, it's not considered the proposal will have a greater impact on the openness of the building than the existing building. There's a small grassed area that exists at present in the northeast of the site, and this is to be retained as a community space. There was an initial objection relating to overlooking from the proposed house to a menage area to the immediate northwest of the site, and the two first floor windows have been removed from the proposal in order to overcome this objection. Therefore, considered the proposal due to its limited size and have no way to impact on the evidence of the greenbelt on the present building, and is therefore recommended for approval subject to the attached condition.
Thank you. Is there one council would like to speak on this?
Yes, please.
If I can ask, just ask you to turn on the microphone, are you happy to be filmed?
Yes, of course. Thank you, committee. I've asked, as it's been listed, that comes to committee due to the impact on the greenbelt. I'm assured that the committee is aware that the leader of the council and many councillors have spoken on many occasions about how this council wants to protect our greenbelt, and we've been very clear in a number of full council meetings that there's quite a unanimous approach across the council about what we feel about our green spaces.
Councillor, could I just ask you to state your name as well, please?
Yeah, sure. It's Councillor Adam Sykes from Glassbridge Ward. As it says in the pack, the application site is within the greenbelt and there is no provision for the proposed developments in the rural UDP policy GB2. And agricultural land is also not considered to be brownfield. The development was listed as an annex, but is in fact not an annex, but instead a separate building. It is also listed as a conversion, but again, it is not a conversion. The proposal is to demolish the existing building and build an entirely new dwelling on the existing site. The development is seen by local residents as the thin end of the wedge and part of the gradual erosion of our greenbelt, for which this council shows so much support. If you also share mine and residents' concerns about protecting the greenbelt on the road, I would ask you to consider to refuse this application tonight. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your drafting. Can I open this up to committee, please? No comments? Steve?
Is there any sort of design pictures that one can maybe have a look at?
Thank you very much for
So the current use for this building is, and the proposed use for the building will be, can you just
yes. The existing use of the building is a workshop, bar, storage barn area, and the proposed use is a dwelling house. Dwelling house.
Stuart.
And again, just for clarity, it's not a conversion of the existing building. Nonetheless, the existing, the new building we're looking at will be smaller in both height and footprint than the existing building. So it's not actually, there's not actually any, if you like, green belts or actively used agricultural land that's being affected by the application.
Okay, it is a smaller footprint, but
I'm
just going to the office to explain about that.
The height to be used is less than the existing building, but the height to the ridge is slightly higher by a metre.
Kathy, through you,